Jarren Williams has been named the starting quarterback for Miami, like all of us thought was going to happen. And all that's coming up after the bumper.
What do you mean you don't subscribe to my son's YouTube channel?
Mama, no!
Just snap the damn ball, RJ.
What's up, kid folk? It's RJ Young. I am not on a step mill. Consider hitting the like and subscribe button because I upload a video every single day. It's always OU-related, college football-related, sports-related. We have a good time. And if you didn't know, I was being facetious. Nobody thought Jarren Williams was going to win this job in Miami, man. He was in a three-horse race with Nikosi Perry and, critically, Tate Martell. And I thought about packaging this segment in with another segment that I wanted to do, but this one just got juicy the more I started thinking about it and the more I started reading about it. Because, one, it kind of is the first major quarterback battle for which we have a winner. And after what Miami has been trying to do in Manny Diaz's time, trying to recreate what he's calling the new you, trying to give the you its swag back in the age of the turnover chain. And then Mark Richt coming to Miami, which is on mod and not being able to get it done. And then Manny Diaz taking the job at Temple only to renege and take the job at Miami as soon as Mark Richt decides to retire. You got this quarterback battle. And then you have the famous Where's Dan from Nick Saban in this really fascinating Athletic article by Bruce Feldman about Dan Enos taking the offensive coordinator quarterback's job at Miami alongside Manny Diaz. And on top of all of that, Tate Martell, a dude from San Diego that decided to go to Bishop Gorman where he was going to be the man, turned out to be one of the best quarterbacks in high school football. Went to Ohio State, sat a year behind Dwayne Haskins thinking that he was going to be the guy this year, and then got Austin Kindled, which is a term that I really love. Because what did Ryan Day do within the first month of himself being installed as the official head coach at Ohio State? He brings in Justin Fields on a transfer, gets the waiver request. That dude becomes immediately eligible, and then Tate Martell chunks up the deuce, says he's going to Miami. In a year where the NCAA transfer portal is still being worked out and we're seeing equilibrium start to come here, right? It's not the barn-burning affair that many people thought it was going to be. It is looking a lot like free agency, but it ain't acting a lot like free agency because Tate Martell was supposed to be the guy at Miami, and then Bubba Bolden followed him from USC. You got all these transfers that came in there because you're trying to rebuild on the fly and try to be competitive because you got a week zero matchup against Florida. So you need to get the quarterback thing right, if nothing else. And Nikosi Perry, who was your on-again, off-again starter, who looked good to start the season, looked worse as the season went on. And then you got Jarren Williams, who played one game and went like 1-3 for 17 yards against Savannah State. Just hadn't done a whole lot. But he was the number 5 overall pro-style quarterback coming out of high school, number 77 overall in his class. Also was an Elite 11 member, so he could throw the ball around, but nobody thought that this would be his job, especially after that was a guy that flirted with leaving Miami before coming out of the transfer portal back to Miami. And apparently, Dan Enos had the money quotes in this, man, because this is his job, this is his position, this is what he wanted to do. And I want to read a couple of those in this story on the 247 sports page for Miami. Just fascinating what has gone on over there. So the first one is, all three guys showed tremendous improvement and development, which is a credit to their hard work and the work of Dan Enos and his offensive staff. Excuse me, that's Manny Diaz talking, not Dan Enos. We believe we can win with all three guys. However, we feel Jarren has the greatest upside due to his ability, passing ability, excuse me, his instincts and his determination. And then later on, the quote from Diaz that I like the most and the one that you hear the most from coaches is, who can avoid the critical errors? That guy touches the ball on every play, so he has the greatest chance to lose your team a game just by making a crazy thing happen. Then it comes down to decision making. The great thing about this offense is that there is going to be an outlet for the quarterback. Do you understand what we have called, what the defense is doing, and where the ball should go? Then finally, do you have the accuracy to get the ball there? I think you can teach those first two things. You can teach quarterbacks everything they need to know about the playbook, about reading coverages and reading defenses. Some of them are going to pick it up quicker than others, but accuracy is still a thing that I think is kind of whimsy-wazzy-fugazi. It's kind of a superpower, depth perception. It's kind of a superpower. Being able to know exactly where you need to put the ball and in what fashion and to where is one thing. Being able to actually do it is another. And that's why big-time college football quarterbacks used to take so long to develop, is you needed them to just get better at hitting that shoebox 50 yards down the field. But now they're coming out much more prepared to do exactly that. And I think Jarren Williams is an example of this that we saw with Trevor Lawrence, that we're seeing around college football, is the young quarterback movement. We're seeing more true freshmen and rookie quarterbacks start earlier in their careers at college football than we've ever seen before, in large part because the dudes are just ready to play, but also because the playbook has become much more simple because the game has become more about math and spacing, with health and safety taking front and center as it should. You're not really going to see the ground and pound anymore. Plus, when you can stymie somebody but you can't keep up with the offense that's scoring 50, like, I'm thinking about Michigan when they're playing Florida. I'm thinking, you know what would have been nice for Michigan if they had Josh Gattis last year? Shea Patterson was running something similar to the air rate and spread that he knows how to run, as opposed to line it up with two tight ends and a fullback and saying we're just going to pound on people. That's great if you can pound on people. But if you're facing a defense that knows how to stop that and can just run fill, you're going to have a hard time, especially when that offense is built to spread you out and take advantage of what you can't do well. If that's in the middle of the defense with your linebackers, cool. If it's in your secondary, cool. They're going to find where your weakness is, and they're going to try to attack it. And you got to be built to do the same thing. It's one of the reasons why Dan Enos going to Miami was such a coup for Manny Diaz. Really, all of the guys that end up being assistants under Nick Saban will be highly sought and will expect them to do great things, Josh Gattis being one at Michigan. But, yo, I'm thinking, okay, if anybody's going to challenge in the ACC, challenge Clemson, who's it going to be? Probably not going to be Vatek. Probably not going to be UVA. You know, we can keep going down the list. Not Florida State. You land on Miami really quickly. That's not to say that Miami's going to have the horses to beat Clemson in an ACC title game or even an ACC matchup. Again, I keep forgetting whether or not they're in two different, if one's in the coast and one's in the Atlantic. I ought to look that up. I should produce that later. Somebody's going to tell me in the comments. But the point that I'm making here is, I don't think that Miami's good enough to beat Clemson, but I do think they're good enough to possibly beat Florida. But I thought that was with Tate Martell as the quarterback. And now with Jarren Williams as the quarterback, guy I haven't seen play ball since high school, really. You're going to get quite the look here. And also, we got all these Tate Martell jokes now, right? Because this is a dude that left Ohio State, was granted immediate eligibility, and sent everybody into a tizzy. Because it felt like all of these quarterbacks were going to get granted immediate eligibility because they had the right lawyer to write up their waiver request. To say nothing of whether or not that dude would even win the job. We just thought that the guy was going to win the job because we thought that he was the best quarterback. Well, now that he hasn't won the job, the joke is, hey, maybe you can transfer to Florida Atlantic and play right away against Ohio State. It's a good joke. I like it. It's also, is he going to drop down and play JUCO because he ain't going to be able to play much this year? It's a good joke, and I like it. But it's a long season, and I think that Manny is actually telling the truth when he feels like all of those guys can help them win games. I think Nikosi Perry is probably at the bottom. And really, when the depth chart comes out, we're going to look at it. We're going to see who's number two on the depth chart. And if it ain't Tate Martell, it's going to tell us a lot. Because Tate Martell talked a lot of noise about how he was going to be the guy at Ohio State, talked a lot of noise about what it was going to look like when he got there. So I'm interested to see that. All right, now I got to go because my girlfriend's calling me. All right, deuces.